So I'm on a speaking tour on my new book, War Against the People, that I thought I'd talk about tonight. It has to do with the Palestinian issue, but in fact, it deals with what I call globalizing Palestine. You know, the Palestinian issue has really become one of the major issues in the world. I mean, everywhere you go in the world, among the other political issues, Palestine is at the center. And it's certainly become emblematic of the fight of peoples, especially oppressed peoples, for their human rights and their national rights. But over the years that I've been an activist, including the 20 years that I've been the head of the Israeli Committee Against House Demolitions, as, you know, I'm in front of bulldozers that are demolishing Palestinian homes, or I witness Palestinian land being taken for settlements, or the building of the wall and the imprisonment of an entire people, and the shootings and the violence and human, you know, violations of basic human rights, of international law. You go to the UN, I mean, there's the Fourth Geneva Convention that very explicitly states what the obligations of an occupying power are. And Israel violates every single one of the items of the Fourth Geneva Convention. And then I look at the United States supporting Israel and Europe supporting Israel and really the international support that governments give to Israel. And the question in the back of my mind that's been nagging me for years was, why? Or how does Israel get away with this? With violation, I mean, we're 50, 60, 70 years after the colonial era. The idea of human rights and international law has percolated into the public consciousness. This is probably the most documented conflict, oppression in history. I mean, with books and films, and it's on TV every day. I mean, it's happening on the southern border of Europe, in the Holy Land, no less. So it's right in the face of churches and synagogues and mosques. And yet Israel gets away with it, or it seems to be getting away with it. The occupation is getting stronger and stronger. The United States and most of Europe have retreated from the two-state solution. And we're today in a situation where nobody is standing in the way of Israel of actually nailing down a new apartheid regime. Israel can build settlements at will. There's not even international protest on the part of the international community. Israel has a campaign now of arresting and even killing children. That's been well documented. Thousands of kids have been beaten and arrested and even killed, including, I mean, some of you might know Salim, if you've heard my talks here before, and Cindy relate, you know, mentioned Salim and Arabia, this family that we know well, whose house has been demolished 6 times, their son was shot about a month ago. Their 13-year-old son, you know, the Israeli army, in a provocative way, intentionally drives into Palestinian villages or urban neighborhoods. And it knows that the kids, teenagers, are going to throw rocks, you know, to repel them, to protest against them. I mean, it's a provocative action to do that. And the kids, understandably, start to throw rocks at the military jeeps. And that gives them the pretext to get out of the jeeps and start shooting either tear gas, rubber bullets, real bullets, and then they run after the kids to go arrest the kids. So they're running. So who gets caught? The slowest kids. So the slowest kids are normally the smallest kids. And you have kids, I'm telling you, 5, 6, 7 years old that are taken by the police, sometimes kept for days without their parents being informed. So you can imagine, you know, you're at home or you're at work, your kids have been picked up and they disappear. You have no idea where they are. And they come back to you eventually traumatized because they're beaten or they're intimidated or they're, for a little kid to be in that kind of a threatening environment is very difficult. Well, Palestinians today are almost afraid to send their kids to school because the Israeli army is virtually, and I'm using this word advisedly, but it is virtually hunting Palestinians. You know, I think Israel's involved today in mop-up operations. And so you've got the violence, you know, you have kids, small kids with scissors or knives trying to attack soldiers or others driving into groups of Israel. In other words, there's a kind of a lashing out of desperation, or I don't know, if it's a 10-year-old kid, what is it? I mean, they don't even have a political consciousness. And it's just kind of a lashing out, I think, out of desperation. And for Israel, of course, this means we've won. And we'll mop up these last gasps of resistance, and it's over. So one of the strategies is to go after the kids. So Palestinians are afraid to send their kids to school, to send them outside, because you never know. It's so arbitrary and so dangerous outside. Arabia sent her 13-year-old son, Anas, out to the corner grocery in their neighborhood to get some groceries. While he's in the grocery store, apparently kids were throwing stones. The army came in, kids throwing stones. And the soldiers are running through the neighborhood grabbing kids. And they grabbed him. He says, it wasn't me. Here's the groceries. I was in the grocery store. Here's the groceries I just bought. It didn't matter. They took him, 13 years old, put him in the Jeep, and drove him into the desert in the West Bank. And in a kind of a wadi, a valley, in the middle of the West Bank, they beat him up, three soldiers, and shot him twice in the leg. Now it's about 5 o'clock in the afternoon, it's getting dark, and they left him. So here's this kid, bleeding, lying in the desert. They assumed that he was gonna die. He was gonna bleed to death. Luckily, there were some Palestinians on a hill not far away that saw what happened. So when the soldiers left, they called an ambulance, and they took the kid, and he was okay, just by luck. So this is kind of the environment that Palestinians are living in. And like I say, it's a kind of a last gasp mopping up operation. So you can begin to ask the question, how indeed does Israel get away with this? The usual explanations that we hear, we think about, didn't really do it for me. The Jewish lobby, or the Israel lobby, or AIPAC. All right, it's true that that has clout in the United States, but it doesn't have clout everywhere in the world. In the last few years, India has become very pro-Israel. Nigeria has supported Israel. Mexico and other countries. Well, there's no AIPAC in those countries. So that works maybe a little bit in the United States, even though I don't think AIPAC runs the United States. Okay. Guilt over the Holocaust is another explanation we often hear. Well, that might work in Germany, where it does work. And in fact, Germany has what it calls a special relationship with Israel. It works a bit in Poland. I don't think it's a factor here. I don't think young people even know there was a Holocaust in the United States. And it certainly doesn't work in South Africa or Azerbaijan or places, India, or places like that. Well, there's a third explanation. Christian fundamentalists, Christian Zionists. Well, that works again in the United States to a limited degree, certainly in the Republican Party, and here and there as well. I mean, Stephen Harper, who was the last Prime Minister of Canada, was an avowed Christian Zionist. You have Christian Zionists in Holland. Otherwise, you don't really have Christian Zionists that exert any influence politically, not in Europe and not in the rest of the world. In other words, I felt there was an elephant in the room. There was some big reason why governments all over the world supported Israel. And I remembered one saying that our friend Henry Kissinger used to say, and that is that countries don't have friends. They have interests. So I was trying to look, what is the interest here that these governments all over the world have to support Israel, even as Israel is losing support among the people? You know, I don't think government support for Israel reflects public opinion. But nevertheless, Israel manages to keep a very high level of relationships and status among governments all over the world. Why? Well, instead of looking down at the occupation, I decided to look up. What is Israel's role in the world? In other words, we think of Israel sometimes, certainly it's the way Israel presents itself, as this little country, a villa in the jungle, this little Jewish boy in a rough neighborhood, this little country struggling to survive, da 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 da. If you look up, all of a sudden, a different picture begins to emerge. Israel, indeed, is a small country. It's about the size of New Jersey. But Israel has military relations, these aren't all the arrows, with about 130 countries in the world that we know of. But it has very extensive security relationships and police relationships. So all of a sudden, little Israel begins to take on another complexion. It's the fourth largest nuclear power in the world. No one is ever going to catch up to the United States. You guys win. There's about 10,000 nuclear warheads in the American arsenal. Israel is tied with France at about 200 to 300 nuclear warheads, which is still, you know, quite a bit, and with multiple means of delivering them. Israel is also the third or fourth or fifth, depends on the year, largest arms exporter. Again, no one's going to catch up to the United States. You have 70% of the arms market. 70% of the new arms that go into the world every year come from the United States. And we have to, and this is a huge industry that we're not very aware of. If you take, you know, since 9/11 in particular, the military and internal security, what we now call homeland security, and the police together. In other words, if you remember before 9/11, there was a very clear distinction between outside and inside. Military, domestic, CIA, FBI, and you even get sometimes in TV shows those tensions. There's a murder somewhere, the FBI comes in, the local police chief says, no, this is my turf, you know, and you've got those inter-turf battles. That's starting to end because with 9/11, one of the lessons was you have to integrate all these forces. Homeland security is not only domestic, but it has to do with external as well. You have the militarization of the police, as you know, in the United States. Ferguson, but, you know, there's a formal Pentagon program to give surplus military equipment to police forces. So if you take the military and home and security and domestic policing together on a global level, it adds up to a $2.5 trillion a year industry. $2.5 trillion a year are spent on the militaries, security forces, and police forces. whoa, that's a pretty significant thing. We don't know much about it. I didn't know much about it. That's why one of the reasons I wrote the book. But here I am on the left, a political activist, trying to contribute to world peace, or whatever you want to call it. And I don't understand. I don't take into account a $2.5 trillion industry. It's got to have tremendous social, political, economic effects on the world. And as we know, some of the largest arms buyers are some of the poorest countries in the world. And the conflicts it generates and so on. So that we're talking about a massive industry that's fairly invisible. Because we're a little bit aware of the military, not really. I mean, who can tell me what an F-35 is? One, two, three and a half. Four, huh? A $1 trillion plane that doesn't work. I mean, a cutting edge kind of stealth bomber kind of, and it's a weapon that the Pentagon itself doesn't want. When Gates was the Secretary of Defense, he tried to cancel it, but you couldn't because Congress is smart, and they of course distribute the assembly of these airplanes and manufacture to every congressional district, so it's going to cost jobs. But the point is that these are huge, expensive weapon systems that we don't know very much about. And I didn't know much about them. But when you go even to small arms, and you go to policing types of equipment, and equipment that's used for security against people, you know even less. Because these policing becomes kind of boring and invisible, and it's every day, and it's not really that much of an issue unless you get a Ferguson that pops up, or you get a special instance of police brutality. But otherwise, it's pretty much background. So I wanted to look at that. But it also, I began to look at it because, again, I was searching for that quid pro quo. How does Israel get away with it? And what I began to see was that Israel, in fact, supplies weapons and security systems and tactics and models of control to elites, I mean, governments or elites all over the world, including corporations that are concerned about, you know, controlling their populations and what we call security. So it turns out that Israel is very strong, and what's interesting here, this is what I call security politics. International politics where you factor in the military, where you factor in this $2.5 trillion industry, and a whole different set of foreign relations begins to emerge, because arms and power and control bypass ideologies. This is where you don't have friends, you have interests. So Israel, as we know, is very close to the global north. This is certainly a key form of support that Israel gets. It's a strategic ally of the United States. You know, by treaty, formally, the United States is obliged to intervene on behalf of Israel if it faces any existential threat from anywhere. By treaty, that's not a choice. In addition, the Congress for the last 30 years or so has a policy of guaranteeing Israel what is called a qualitative military edge over all its neighbors in the Middle East combined. It's called QME. And in other words, the United States is engaged in its own internal arms race against itself. Because if you sell, like you did last year, $7 billion in cutting-edge weapons to Saudi Arabia, which is not exactly a paragon of human rights, you have to guarantee that Israel doesn't lose its qualitative military edge over Arab countries that get these arms. So you have to increase, either qualitatively or quantitatively, the amount of arms that Israel gets. So, for example, selling these arms to Saudi Arabia, Israel was granted a whole squadron of F-35s, these cutting-edge, and Israel is going to get these planes before the American Air Force does. And they cover they kill two birds with one stone. On the one hand, they help guarantee Israel this qualitative military edge because they're getting a kind of cutting-edge weaponry that the Arab states won't get, no matter how much money they pay. And on the other hand, Israel tests them. I mean, why is Israel getting them before the American Air Force? It would be much better to have Israeli pilots test F-35s on in the region in different ways than to have American pilots test them in Texas somewhere. That's maybe less so today with some of the conflicts, but the United States is very reluctant to deploy the F-35s. They're not right deployable now, so they use Israel as a kind of a test case. So Israel has then from the United States this qualitative military edge guaranteed, which means last week, President Obama signed a bill giving Israel $40 billion in new arms. Just Israel. $40 billion in new arms over a 10-year period between 2018 and 2028. That increases by $10 billion the $30 billion in arms that Bush granted Israel in the decade before. So in the 20 years, between 2008 and 2028, this little country, the size of New Jersey, in the most volatile area of the world, is getting $70 billion of American weaponry. Now you imagine what Washington, the state of Washington, could do with $70 billion. It could fix a few bridges. So that it's a and in addition to that, Israel has access, privileged access to American military technologies. Intel, for example, which is really a military company, has research and development hubs in the Silicon Valley, Ireland, and Israel. And so Israel is engaged in all kinds of joint projects with with the United States. For example, Israel can't produce an F-35. It's way too big. It's a small country. It could never afford to build it. But Israel does what it calls niche filling. In order to make itself indispensable, it supplies high-tech components to weapon systems in a way that you can't have these systems without some Israeli input. So a lot of the cockpit of the F-35 is in fact Israeli, meaning the avionics, the electronic, all the electronics of the, not all, but a lot of the electronics of the plane, the radar, the targeting, and of course these are technologies that Israel is then able to bring back to use on the Palestinians and to develop on the Palestinians. Israel is also very close to Europe, of course. There's all kinds of projects, including the Watchkeeper, which is the new European drone that's being developed, which is an Israeli drone. Israel is also a part of NATO. It's not a member of NATO, but it's in what's called the NATO neighborhood, which means it does joint exercises with NATO, and its weapons are interoperational with those of NATO. But again, security politics bypasses ideologies. So here we have a situation where Israel seems dependent on the United States. You know, we're America's most loyal ally. We love America. We share common values. Netanyahu's invited to speak before Congress every 3 weeks. You know, and imagine Israel's special influence in this country. Here you had, a few months ago, Netanyahu, a foreign head of state, invited by the Republican Party into the American Congress, where he was welcomed by both parties. A joint session, almost the entire House and Senate together sitting. A foreign head of state addresses Congress to oppose a policy of your own president. And his own party supports the foreign head of state over your own president. And not only that, in the 20-minute speech of Netanyahu to the American Congress, he got a standing ovation 42 times. The Israeli press were laughing. The Israeli press said the American Congress looked like the North Korean parliament. Up and down and up and down and up and down, both parties. So Israel really has this kind of input into the United States, but also into other parts of the global north. But it doesn't end there. There's a whole group of countries that are challenging the hegemony, the domination of Europe and the United States. And they're called, you know this term, the BRICS countries. The BRICS are Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa. These are countries that have very powerful emerging economies. I mean, China today, I think, has the world's largest economy, or second largest, that are challenging, again, the Euro-American domination. And you can add to them another block of countries that are sort of joining him called the MINT countries, which is Mexico, Indonesia, Nigeria, and Turkey. And these countries know that they're a block. They have summit meetings every couple of years. And there's all kinds of plans. So this isn't just some conceptual thing. These are the arch rivals to some degree of the United States, led, of course, by China. I mean, the United States is moving the entire Sixth Fleet into the South Pacific. They're very concerned about China, militarily, politically in the region. Economically, of course, China kind of owns the American economy. And then you begin to look at the map from an arms point of view, and look, the second largest arms supplier to China is Israel. Your ally, your friend, the only democracy in the Middle East, is the number two arms supplier to your arch rival, China, after Russia. Now, there's a Cold War kind of beginning again with Russia and Putin and so on. So here's Russia, followed by Israel, supplying the Chinese military that the United States is very concerned about. And then you look, India. Israel is the second, third, fourth, it depends what year, largest arms supplier to India, after Russia. So here's little Israel that's supplying two of the largest militaries in the world. Not to mention, I won't get into it all, Nigeria, in every single BRICS MINT country, Israel is present and very strong. But not only there, Israel is also present in almost the entire global south, the developing countries, what we call the third world sometimes. I would argue that Israel has more global reach in terms of military security policing than the United States does. People say, well, that's crazy. The Pentagon's budget alone is $1 trillion a year. How could that be? And it's true. You have military bases in 174 countries, which is pretty good since there's only 193 countries in the world. But the presence is kind of shallow, because when you have a military base, they're doing military exercises, or they're setting off to go attack somebody, but more or less the soldiers, the sailors, the pilots are confined to base, pretty much. You know, they have a kind of McDonald's land, and they fly in and ship out and this and that, but the local people don't feel them very much. Whereas Israel has military relations, again, with 130 countries, not bases, but certainly relations, but Israel is also training your security services and your special operations forces and your presidential guard and then your police forces. So here we have a situation, it arose in Ferguson, where you have the Israeli police training the American police. And this gets into this whole thing I mentioned before about separation. Countries normally do not allow foreign countries into their police forces, into their prisons, into their border controls, into their internal security, because that's where your sovereignty is. That's the essence of American, you know, that's an internal business. You're a foreign country. Stay out of our internal affairs, right? Well, certainly Israel doesn't do that in Congress. But at the same time, it also is invited in a very unique way, into the heart of your domestic scene. I don't know about the police in Olympia. It's a good question to ask. But certainly Israel trains the LAPD, and the chief of police in Portland, where I just was, just came back from Israel for training not long ago. So that one question is, to what degree is your police department trained by Israel, using Israeli equipment? And this, of course, gets to this whole issue of the occupation. Because Israel, in my, you know, you can ask another question. Why didn't Israel accept the two-state solution 30 years ago when Arafat and the PLO offered it? The two-state solution is a very pro-Israel solution. Israel gets peace and security, recognition not only by the Palestinians but by the entire Arab League in what's called the Arab Peace Initiative, plus the whole international community, and 78% of the country. The Palestinian state is only on 22% of historic Palestine, even though the Palestinians will be the majority in the country. So it's a tremendous pro-Israel solution. Why didn't Israel grab that? If it really wants peace and security, why didn't it grab that offer 30 years ago? We could have been 30 years into peace in Israel-Palestine. Who knows how that would have played out in the rest of the Middle East. Why not? And what I want to suggest is that we have to look at the occupation not as a threat or a burden on Israel, but rather as a resource, that it's a laboratory. Not many countries have millions of people that they can practice on. They can develop and test weapons. You can't explain, for example, the attack on Gaza last year in 2014 in military terms. The actual threat of these primitive Qassam rockets that had very limited range and so on did not justify the disproportionate attack of a conventional army on a little country, on a little piece of land densely populated with no army, of artillery and the Navy and laser-guided missiles and air forces with F-16s and drones and tanks. I mean, it was the invasion of Normandy in Little Gaza. You can't explain that in purely military terms. It has to have been an exercise. It has to have been a way of testing weapons. And in fact, in my book, I list the weapons that Israel used for the first time in the attack on Gaza, including a new drone. So that if you look at the occupation as a laboratory and as a resource, you begin to understand why Israel wants to maintain a kind of a manageable conflict. It doesn't want peace, because peace, without the occupation, Israel would not have an edge in the military market. Without the occupation, in peace, Israel would not be the fourth largest nuclear power in the world. In peace, Israel would be New Zealand. It'd be a nice little country to go visit. And a lot of people would say, well, you know, that's not so bad. Being New Zealand isn't such a bad option. But that's not the way Israel sees itself. It sees itself as a regional hegemon. And in our world, countries, their clout and their status in the world is measured by how many missiles they have, how many planes they have, how many ships they have, and so on. So that Israel is then able to use the occupation and its relationships as a quid pro quo for working with elites and governments all over the world. I mean, literally all over the world, and I talk about that in the book. But there's another level that I want to also mention, and that is the capitalist world system we live in. I mean, we don't talk about capitalism very much. We have a feeling that we're in a system that's not so great. You had the Occupy Wall Street movement, the 99%, 1%. I mean, we know something's wrong. But the only one almost that talks about capitalism as capitalism, even that term seems a little bit kind of old-fashioned and awkward. The only one is Naomi Klein. She talked about the shock doctrine. She talks about her latest book is Climate Change and Capitalism. But capitalism is, in fact, the world system that we live in. It affects every element of our lives, and it has a logic to it. And in this capitalist world system, you have ruling classes. I mean, it's not all simplistic, you know, but you have ruling classes. You have dominant interests. You have some groups that are more powerful than others. You know, Oxfam came out with a report about 2 weeks ago that 1% of the world's population owns half the world's resources. So this isn't just some conspiracy theory. There are ruling classes, and there are classes, as we know. And so that in this system, you know, capitalism has a hegemony. The problem is that as the system becomes more unsustainable, it has to become more repressive. Capitalism has always tried to present a happy face. It wants to disappear. You know, there's a story about two fish that meet. And one fish says to the other one, "How's the water?" And the other fish says, "What water?" Or, "What's water?" In other words, we're living in this sea of capitalism, but we don't feel it. It's invisible to us. We don't talk about it, and so on. And it goes by consensus. You know, Ronald McDonald and our toys, our computer toys, and the movies, and Hollywood, and this and that. That's the way it prefers to work. You don't feel it. You like it. It's comfortable. It's happy. We're the good guys, and so on. But, as we know, as the system becomes more unsustainable, it's using resources at a rate that simply the world can't sustain. The United States has 4% of the world's population and uses 40% of the world's resources. One country, not to mention Canada, Japan, all of Europe. Two-thirds of humanity are classified by corporations as surplus humanity. How's that for a theological concept? Surplus humanity or disposable humanity. In other words, these are people, Africa, a lot of the global south, not to mention poor people in the global north as well. These are people that will never be educated, will never be upwardly mobile, will never be productive in the capitalist sense of the term. And the worst sin is they'll never be consumers. So they're disposable. They're surplus. And as the system excludes more and more people, but at the same time, the wars we have today are resource wars, because many of these poor people live on top of valuable but ever more scarce resources. Remember the bumper sticker from the first Iraq war? How did our oil get under their sand? Remember that? That's exactly the issue. How do we extract their resources but leave them outside the system? And including our own kids. I mean, the Occupy movement was really a movement of middle-class kids that feel more and more young people excluded. They don't have any job security. There's no more unions. Everybody's working in McDonald's-like jobs. They have no job security. And so as the system excludes more and more people, and more people feel exploited and insecure, as there's more resistance of different kinds, the system has to, the happy face drops, and the system is able to enforce its hegemony. Enforcing hegemony, this is an interesting thing. In looking and doing my book, I began to learn a lot more about war than I ever knew. I mean, again, this isn't anything I know. I knew, and I still don't. I'm still not an expert. But I'm starting to get a grasp on it. When we think of war, we think of war. You know, airplanes and battleships and armies and soldiers, war. But in fact, what we think of as war, conventional interstate wars, don't happen anymore. They're gone. The last real interstate war was World War II. You might say Korea, maybe the extension of that Korea. After that, there's been a few episodic interstate wars. Iran-Iraq, the war in the Falklands, that was a great war. The 1973 war between Egypt, Israel, and Syria. But these, in a global sense, these are episodic and fairly localized. So the kind of war that the Pentagon is preparing for with F-35s and nuclear missiles, not just the Pentagon, Britain is investing £11 billion in the Trident nuclear system, a Trident nuclear arms that the Ministry of Defense in Britain says it doesn't need. It has no enemy. It has no enemy to use that on. But again, these are arms that give jobs, or fake jobs in a sense, and give a country a lot of status. So you've got the Pentagon with this huge arsenal of weapons that are fairly irrelevant. I mean, as you were saying actually before, you look at what's happening in Syria and Afghanistan and other places, the United States isn't doing very well, or Britain or the whole coalition and so on, because these aren't interstate wars. These are instead what generals are calling a new paradigm of war, which is war, what they call it is wars amongst the people. This is the new form of warfare, wars amongst the people. I changed it, and hence the title of my book, within the capitalist context, that in fact these are wars against the people. We can't pretend they're simply technically wars that happen to be fought in cities. These are wars against the people. This is the kind of warfare we have today. Both what are called hybrid wars, asymmetrical conflicts, in other words, states fighting non-state actors. What we're doing with ISIS, Daesh, Al-Qaeda, the Taliban, Mexican drug cartels, Colombian drug cartels, peasant groups all over the world, you know, insurgents, as we call them, terrorists sometimes we call them. And look at all the different kinds of language we use, terms we use for those kinds of wars. Counterinsurgency, of course, and others. The other form of war against the people, these are foreign kind of wars, are what I call securocratic wars. These are wars within our own society, within the United States, for example. They're a form of class warfare. So that, look, you've got, look at the language we use, the war on crime. I mean, this is a domestic issue. Why? See, the military metaphor, the war on drugs. So it begins to justify a militarized response, homeland security, bridges that difference between the military, security, and policing that had always been very important in the United States. And it leads to a state of emergency. You're living in a state of emergency. You've been living under the Patriot Act since 9/11. The Patriot Act is a draconian act that curbs your domestic liberties, your civil liberties, that poses a real threat to civil liberties, And it was enacted, what, a week maybe after 9/11. Don't tell me the members of Congress sat all night in Congress and drafted this bill in a week. It was there. It was in the drawer. And the American people would not have allowed it until the trigger of 9/11. I don't want to get into conspiracy. I mean, I don't think 9/11 was, you know, some conspiracy. But when that event happened, it gave the justification for a state of emergency. You have it in France today. After the attacks in Paris, the French government declared a state of emergency, which means that the police and the security forces and the military together have powers that really threaten your democratic protections. Now, it's supposed to be for 3 months. Let's see. We're almost at the end of 3 months. States of emergency are normally not canceled. They're actually what governments prefer because it gives governments powers that it wouldn't have otherwise. Israel has lived in a state of emergency since 1945. It still is run in many ways by the British era emergency regulations of 1945. I mean, we're still in an emergency. We're the fourth largest nuclear power in the world, you know, over a few Palestinians. What's the emergency? The emergency comes because that's what gives the military and the government the powers, the unusual powers. So you can be a democracy, but a democracy in a state of emergency that suspends all those things, down to policing. This is war today. War against the people. And Israel's, of course, not the only country, but Israel fills this niche in a much better way than the United States does. The United States doesn't have much experience in wars amongst the people, and the experience it's had hasn't been very good. It doesn't have the weaponry for this. It's not structured for this. And therefore, a country like Israel becomes the go-to country when you're the LAPD, or when you're, when you're trying to fight wars like are being fought against the people today. And this is a huge niche then that Israel, this is part of the quid pro quo. So without getting into this too much, I'm not going to make this too long. Israel then is a small country. It can't, again, build battleships and F-35s or whatever. So it niche fills. I mean, the Ministry of Defense in Israel surveys the scene. What do the elites of the world need to ensure their control? And then we'll provide it in a very strategic and focused kind of a way. So one niche is high-tech weaponry and components for weapon systems. A second niche is what I call weapons of suppression or repression. These are weapons really used on people in hybrid warfare and securocratic war, models of securitization, and I've developed this idea of a matrix of control that Israel has laid over the occupied territory that it can now export as a model. And framing and lawfare, how do you sell it? So I just want to focus on niche two. For a minute, because one of the reasons I wrote the book, for my own self as well, was that I had no idea what military technologies are. In other words, here I'm trying to be a political activist and fight for a better world, da 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 da. And I don't know what the militaries and police have technologies of repression and control that we have no idea of. Most of us come from, I would venture to guess, come from the social sciences or the humanities, not from the hard sciences. How many people here come from the hard sciences? What, insurance is a... Yeah. How do you... Do it? Okay. One and a half, two maybe. In other words, most of us don't know what these technologies are. And so when we don't know, And when sometimes we hear about latest the cutting-edge technologies, we think it's science fiction. So I'm trying to kind of expose that and let us know what we're facing, what forces we're facing in these spheres. Now, Israel, like I said, before I get into weapons of repression, Israel also has conventional weapons. It's a very powerful country in terms of normal conventional warfare methods. For example, Israel, again, is the third largest nuclear power in the world, third or fourth, advised with France. But it has multiple means of delivery. For example, Israel produces its own intercontinental ballistic missile, the Jericho series. So, sitting here in Olympia, okay. But when I give this talk in London, and I say, look, here's London. It happens to be within the range of Israeli nuclear missiles. Why are you so concerned about Iran that doesn't have nuclear missiles? And here's a country, Israel, that's kind of a rogue country, very unpredictable, getting very nutty, that has the means to deliver nuclear weapons anywhere. And this isn't just some paranoia. Seymour Hersh wrote a book a while ago called The Samson Option about Israel's nuclear policy. Israel's policy is this, and it's like the ultimate extortion. If we go down, we're not going down alone. If we're threatened existentially, we'll let these nuclear rockets go, and we're not going to tell you in what direction. So in a sense, it's holding the entire global community hostage to that threat. Now, what does that mean? Well, we're talking about the two-state solution. The two-state solution means the West Bank becomes a Palestinian state. Israel considers the Jordan Valley, its border with Jordan, to be its security border. Its most important border. And Israel says, if we lose control of the Jordan Valley, that is an existential threat to the country. So, and this is the doctrine of the current Minister of Defense, Moshe Yaalon. So you can make the argument that if, in fact, the international community pressed Israel towards a two-state solution, Israel would see that as an existential threat that could conceivably trigger some nuclear reaction. So these things aren't completely crazy. You know, there's a logic and a military logic and a political logic to this. Israel makes its own, can't make an F-35, but it makes a pretty sophisticated jet fighter called the Kfir that's especially used in global south countries. It has a whole series of missiles, many of which are nuclear-capable missiles, like the Gabriel. And you see how Israel sells them? I took this off the websites of the companies that sell them. Combat-proven. Combat-proven. Well, who are they proving them on, do you think? Nuclear submarines. Israel is taking delivery of 9 nuclear-capable submarines. What is that all about? What are they going to attack Tulkarm with nuclear submarines? There's a whole military agenda here. Talk about quid pro quo pros. There's a whole military agenda with these submarines. For example, one nuclear submarine of Israel went through the Suez Canal and was patrolling on the southern border of Iran in the Persian Gulf, an Israeli nuclear-capable submarine. Well, who knows that? I mean, it explains a little bit Iranian behavior, or certainly it would explain why the Iranians would consider going in a nuclear direction if they got India and Pakistan on one side with nuclear weapons and Russia over here and Israel, not only with nuclear weapons that can reach Iran, but with nuclear submarines that are patrolling a southern border. You see, so without this kind of context, it's hard to explain the behavior of countries in international politics. This is also a huge laboratory because Israel couldn't build it. It's built in shipyards in Germany. These are German submarines. But they're filled up with Israeli electronics, again, paid for by Germany, This is where the guilt over the Holocaust kicks in. Paid for by the EU, Israel gets more foreign aid from the Europe than any other non-European country. And Israel gets two-thirds of American foreign aid. This one little country gets much more money than all of Africa. So you put all those things together with privileged access to technology, and these, each one of these submarines becomes a huge laboratory. And no wonder Israel is a high-tech center for startup companies, because they're coming out of the military. Israel makes a very sophisticated tank. But especially Israel specializes, again, in high-tech components for weapon systems. This is, for example, a targeting pod that every Air Force in the world uses. And forms of warfare like cyber warfare, which is called the fifth form of warfare. The United States and Israel are the two leaders. They've already attacked Iran with cyber warfare. And this is one of the most powerful and least known. I mean, what do I know? I have trouble with my email. Cyber warfare can completely destroy societies, kill many more people than nuclear missiles. You shut down entire national systems and grids and so on. And again, it's a form of warfare that Israel and the United States specialize in. But in particular, what I focus on with the wars against the people are what I call weapons of repression that are actually used against people, both on a military but also on a policing level. Well, why would I start with a satellite? I mean, that's sort of far away from people. It's not the policeman on the beat. Because this has a direct effect, of course, on people. Israel is one of seven countries that has the capability of launching satellites into space by itself. And one of its series of spy, surveillance, communication satellites are the Ofik series. There's actually Ofik 10 is about to be launched. So your Facebook, just to make this personal, your Facebook just paid $100 million to an Israeli military company for access to Ofik 10 that will give it access to Africa. It'll open up Africa for Facebook. So here's a direct relationship between you and a spy satellite and Israel. There's all kinds of technologies. I'm not going to get into it now at 8 o'clock at night. But there's all kinds of technologies that Israel is one of the world's leaders of that we're not aware of. For example, nanotechnology. Israel is the world's leader in the military applications of nanotechnology. Now, nanotechnology has a very benign image for most people because it's connected to biomedicine. You have a heart problem, and your doctor can put a nano monitor in your inside your blood vein. It's how small it is to monitor your blood flow, for example. I mean, there's a million other applications, pacemakers, and nanotechnology is very important in biomedicine. But these all come out of military applications because the military has the money, the billions of dollars, to develop new technologies in their early stages before they're commercially viable for commercial companies. So the military plays a key role. I mean, the internet is one example, was developed by the Pentagon. But a lot of the technologies we have are byproducts of military development. So think of the military as being the cutting edge of technology. We're getting sort of the second level of that, and that becomes a kind of a frightening prospect. So, for example, Israel has, well, nanotechnologies are called by the military nano warriors. A nano is a billionth of a meter. It's the size of a molecule. So you can imagine weapons the size of a molecule. You can take a nano warrior, and you can enhance it with artificial intelligence so that a nano warrior can be smarter than we are, and you can and you can weaponize it. So, for example, you can create what are called nanoviruses. You can, you know, if it's a molecular size or a couple molecules, you can spread it over an entire population. It's an invisible weapon. You don't see a nano or even a few nanos together. It's like dust, but even finer than dust. So you can, you could target the DNA with nanobots of an entire population. You could target the nervous systems of an entire population. You could take an entire population and make them forget. In other words, these are kind of the ultimate of biological weapons. Another weapon of suppression or repression are drones. Israel produces 40% of the world's drones. Why? Why didn't the United States produce the world's drones? It's a good example of how the development of weapons follows your conception of war. Drone technology began in the 1970s. The Americans decided not to go into drones because they're stupid weapons in conventional warfare. In other words, what does a drone do? A drone hangs in the air. It hangs in the air, so you can shoot, anybody can shoot it down. So the Americans, looking at conventional warfare, were fighting other air forces, say, we don't need that kind of a weapon, it's crazy. Israel in the 1970s was fighting another kind of a war, which was war against the people, and the people don't have air forces. Palestinians, Hezbollah, Egypt, in the war of attrition, so they couldn't shoot down drones. And the drone does things that human beings can't do. It hovers for days and weeks and months. It hovers and hovers, and it tracks and it follows and it surveys. And when necessary, it targets and kills somebody. In other words, these are perfect weapons of repression. And they're used by police forces more and more. But they weren't developed originally by the United States because, again, the United States wasn't fighting until recently wars against the people. All kinds of automatic weapon systems I won't get into now. This is the kind of an Israeli tank that's called the LIC, which is low-intensity conflict, built for urban warfare, places like Gaza. And Caterpillar bulldozers that I testified the day before yesterday in the Portland City Council to try to get the Portland City Council to divest from Caterpillar. These are weapons of repression. The D9 bulldozer is especially designed to demolish Palestinian homes. And then it's used in other parts of the world as well because these techniques developed in Israel are then exported to other countries. It's amazing, for example, how much the techniques of occupation have been used in Iraq, including house demolitions, the building of walls, a civil administration. I mean, it was almost like a replication of the Israeli occupation in Iraq. The D9 bulldozer is a two-story bulldozer. It's a mining machine. But it's especially designed by Caterpillar as a military machine. It's sold to Israel as military equipment. And the difference is that that the shovel of the bulldozer is designed in a way that when it hits a Palestinian building, the building falls away from the driver. If you hit an apartment building with a normal bulldozer, it'll collapse on the driver. It's not made for that. It's made for mining and earthworks. So you design the bulldozer in a way that it hits a Palestinian home and it falls away from the driver. But in addition, you see there's a hook here in the D9. What is that all about? It's a hydraulic hook that you go into a city, whether it's Gaza, Bethlehem. It was used a lot in Operation Defensive Shield in 2002, Ramallah, Nablus, Jenin, and so on. you go into a city and you shove that hook into the pavement. And then this powerful machine drives up and down the streets of a city, ripping out all the infrastructure. The sewage lines, the electrical lines, the telephone lines, everything. And what I said to the city of Portland yesterday, the day before yesterday, was this isn't only a house demolition machine, it's a city demolition machine. And does Portland really want to be invested in a technology of destroying cities? So these are weapons of repression, down to, there's micro drones. The Technion is Israel's largest polytechnic university and really the laboratory for the Israeli army. if you want a BDS target, I would investigate, because it probably does the Technion have a relationship with a university in Washington State? You know, this has been a big campaign in Canada, because almost every major Canadian university has a relationship with the Technion. So this brings the occupation into your community. You know, and I think it's a very powerful target. So the Technion develops micro drones, mimicking insects. How's this for a drone? The head, that's on the tip of somebody's finger. And the head, this is, you know, a cylinder with poisons. And these are cameras. So that's how tiny, but that's not the last word. You can also weaponize insects themselves. You can take cockroaches, flies, other kinds of insects, and turn them into weapons of surveillance or even killing. Down to, again, the police forces, the militarization of the police, so that, for example, the development of SWAT teams and all kinds of weaponry for police. Now, here's something interesting. I'm going to finish in a minute. The part of war that is invisible, that we don't see, is policing. Because, again, police either go after bad guys, or they're in parts of the city you don't see, or, you know, they're just back. They're not sexy. I mean, there's some TV shows, but basically police weapons are small weapons. They're not very dramatic. You don't have dramatic battles. And so people, this side of warfare, but in war against the people, war is actually mainly policing. It's police operations, we call them, or peacekeeping operations, or you know, the kinds of wars that we have, including actual policing. For example, these small arms that we really don't, you know, we talk about nuclear weapons. There's a whole movement against nuclear weapons. But small arms kill infinitely more people than nuclear weapons, F-35s, and battleships together, and armies together. And most of the people they kill are actually women and children. So look, there's 875 million small arms in the world. These are arms that can be carried by people, whether they're rifles or even mortars or pistols, you know, those kinds of guns. There's 870 million small arms, of which 650 million are in 75% are in civilian hands. Look, the armies of the world only have about 200 million. Arms out of 875 million. So 75% of the weapons in the world are in civilian hands, small weapons, and in the U.S., 270 million of them. In other words, almost half of those weapons are of U.S. civilians. And then 200 million are controlled by armed forces, and 26 million by law enforcement agencies. And gang members hold another 2 to 10 million. All the non-state actors, we're talking about ISIS, you know, Al-Qaeda, all these non-state actors that we're fighting, Boko Haram and so on, only have about 1.4 million small arms. In other words, they're about a 0.5% of what American civilians have. And these kinds of arms kill many more people than the big ones. I mean, I'm saying this to call attention to the importance of policing, the police side of war, and that's what Israel also specializes in because of its war against the Palestinians all these years. So all kinds of crowd control devices, tear gas and pepper sprays, and what you see in Berlin. You know, there's one Palestinian in Berlin that's been fighting the wall for years and years and years. You know the film Five Broken Cameras. He's collected more than 100 canisters of different kinds of liquids and sprays and powders and materials that have been used in crowd control by the Israeli army. And here, I put this up because these are some of the most effective crowd control and riot control equipment, but they're boring. I mean, you take this equipment, which is actually pretty sophisticated, you put it on a Chevy chassis. I mean, who's going to go out and demonstrate against that? It's a boring, everyday kind of, it's not even a weapon, it's a truck that the police have. But these are actually weapons of suppression, much more important for people, whether in cities or in the third world, than the weapons that armies have. And they kill and control many more people. Fences coming out of the West Bank, and certainly surveillance systems. I mean, Israel's got 600 checkpoints, millions of Palestinians passing through every day. No wonder Israel's a world leader in airport security. And bringing these systems into your cities. For example, these security companies talk about human security states. This is a concept they're trying to push beyond democracy. And they're trying to say security trumps democracy. And you know where you have that today? The fight of Apple against the FBI over access to this telephone, right? This is exactly, and the FBI is saying, no, security trumps everything. And I'll bet you the majority of Americans are going to back the FBI against Apple on this. So security becomes this, but security isn't a neutral term. It's not technical. But if you put it within this context of a capitalist world system, security is serving somebody's interests. Who's the enemy? Who are we securing? Why? So a term I use, the subtitle of the book is called global pacification. If you use the word security, it's just security. Everybody wants to be secure. There's no problem here. Security closes down any questioning. Of course I want security. But if you replace the word security by the word pacification, I want to be secure. Do I want to be pacified? Oh, wait a minute now. Pacification begins to open up all kinds of questions that didn't exist before. Who's pacifying me? Why are they pacifying me? How are they pacifying me? And all of a sudden, this whole world of interests and powers all comes into play. And so here you get these systems, and they appear to be just normal technical surveillance and seizure systems. But the question is, who are they picking up? And, you know, you've got this concept of crime prevention today. Crime prevention used to mean, you know, you keep track of criminals and you know when a drug deal is coming down and you prevent it. Today it means you have these systems and you build databases on all of us. These cameras aren't just cameras, the CCTV and digital cameras that are being installed in your cities, but they do facial recognition, biometrics, which is eye recognition. If you have a twitch or you have a particular way of walking, there's all kinds of ways that identify. And over time, they build for everybody. They build a pattern of movement, where you've been and where you're going. So in a sense, crime prevention becomes predicting that you're going to commit a crime, whether or not you've decided to commit a crime or not, and you can be picked up on that basis. It's like the preventive war that Bush was, that the concept that Bush was pushing. So these, and look at these systems. What they go after are what are called spaces of anonymity. You know, security states get very nervous if you're anonymous. They don't know who you are, who you're meeting, what you're talking about, where you are. They get, and so the point of these systems is not only to survey and to be sure that everybody's safe and to catch a car thief, but is to be sure that there's no more spaces of, there's no surprises. And again, if you think of this as being in the service of particular classes and interests, it takes on a whole different perspective. So these are some of the things that I, Frank Zappa should have the last word. But these are some of the issues that the Israeli occupation brings up that are in fact kind of global issues. And so what I'm trying to do is, together with my work in opposing the occupation, to again to use Israel as a vehicle for kind of uncovering and understanding. You know, Israel over Palestine is a microcosm of the larger world. And to understand that, it's very interesting to trace the threads out from Israel to the larger world. So I'll leave it at that. I have a slogan that I'm selling, and that is BDS for BDS. In other words, boycotts of essence and sanctions, which is our campaign of putting pressures on Israel, economic and others on Israel to resolve this conflict. But it has to be connected to an end game. It has to be for something. Why are we BDSing? And we haven't really formulated that very clearly. And that's one of the problems. I think we all know, many of us know the two-state solution is gone. But we, Palestinians and Israelis that are there, that want peace, a just peace, haven't yet really formulated the alternative. So your question is a very good question. It's not naive at all. In fact, it's right on, because this is exactly the vacuum that exists. You know, people are saying, okay, we're against the occupation. If the two-state solution is gone, what do you want? And we should be providing an answer. We're not there yet. There isn't an agreed solution. The Palestinians themselves have to sit among themselves and begin to formulate. But what I'm suggesting, just to kind of get the discussion going, is a binational democratic state. In other words, to say to Israel, look, you've made this country one country. I mean, Israel eliminated the two-state solution deliberately, systematically, and it's incorporated what we call the West Bank, that Israel calls Judea and Samaria, into Israel. I would argue there is no more occupation. There's 600,000 Israelis living, most of them in cities, in what we call the occupied territory, which is Judea and Samaria. The thrust of Zionism from the very beginning, 100 years ago, was to Judaize the country. I mean, that sounds a little bit like an anti-Semitic word, but it's the term that Israel and Zionism have always used. You find that term in Israeli government papers and planning. We're Judaizing the country. We're making, the idea is to transform Palestine into the land of Israel and all of it. And I would argue that it's been done pretty much. In other words, if you take, I don't know if the Palestinians are half the population of this country today. Okay? But they're confined in the West Bank to what are called areas A and B. These little brown places here, about 70 little islands on 40% of the West Bank. And They're in little islands of East Jerusalem, but there is no more East Jerusalem. The Palestinian part of the city taken in 1967 was formally annexed to Israel in 1967. It doesn't exist anymore. And in fact, with settlements inside the city, there are more Israelis living in East Jerusalem than there are Palestinians today. So Palestinians here too are reduced to little enclaves in an Israeli-controlled part of a larger Israeli-controlled city. And then you have, of course, little Gaza, which is a cage. But inside Israel itself, the Palestinian Arab population is 20% of the Israeli population, and yet it's confined by zoning and planning to 3.5% of the land. So if you take it all together, the Palestinians are half the population of this country, but they're confined to 10% of the land. And that in all kinds, dozens of little enclaves. So basically, Israel has already not just eliminated the two-state solution, but has created one state. There is today one state. And between the Mediterranean and the Jordan River, there's only one government. I mean, don't tell me the Palestinian Authority is really an effective government. Obviously, there's only one army here. There's only one currency. Whether you're in Gaza or Hebron or Tel Aviv, you're using the shekel, all controlled by the Bank of Israel. There's only one electrical system of the Israeli electrical company. There's only one water system of Mikorot. There's only one highway system. By any measure, this is one integrated, functioning country. So not only is a two-state solution dead, but I would go here. This is where I would go. Although we're not there, but this is where I would go. I would say, okay, Israel, I want to put the burden on Israel. Okay, Israel, you eliminated the two-state solution. You created one state in this country. We accept that. It's one state. That's the reality. Okay. But that one state that you created is an apartheid state. It's a state where one population dominates the other, whether it's in terms of privileged rights or militarily or in land or in economy, in every measure, it's apartheid. And that we can't accept. So it seems to me our goal is crystal clear. That is to turn this one state that Israel created from an apartheid state into a democratic state of equal rights for all its citizens. I don't see another option at all. And that's where I would like us to go. I would also like to insert a binational element. And that is that this isn't Kansas. It isn't just a bunch of voters. But there are, in fact, two national groups in the country, Palestinian Arabs and Israeli Jews, and their national collective identities are important to them. So I think in a constitution, it'd be very much like the UK or Canada or Spain. You would say this is one state of equal rights for everyone, one parliament, and so on, but we recognize the existence and the integrity of two national groups. And those groups will be allowed to have their own institutions if they want, their own language, their own, the integrity of their culture will be preserved. In other words, to make it unconstitutional to pass laws that really violate the cultural integrity of either group. And if you do that double system where people here have both their individual rights protected in a democracy, but their collective rights protected in a binational state, I think that's a win-win. Everybody lives in the country. You can live anywhere you want to. There's genuine equality. And at the same time, you can continue to be a Palestinian Arab. with all your heritage, and you can continue to be an Israeli Jew without impinging on the other. So that's where I would go, if you're asking. Well, you know, I didn't come to tell you how we're going to fight back. I mean, we have to fight back. With all this stuff, how do we fight back? Weapons of repression and global warming and I'm putting some words in your mouth. Unsustainable, maybe capitalist system or system. Well, how do we fight back? I mean, this is pretty, and it's true. I should say that I don't mean to intimidate us. I want us to sort of understand what we're facing, what the threats are, so we can begin to develop strategies of resistance. So I think one thing we have, you know, it's interesting. We have, like I said, we haven't formulated our own just solution to the Israel-Palestine conflict. But at the same time, we haven't formulated what we would want or how to replace the capitalist system that we have. We know it's unsustainable. We know it's exploitative. We know it's unequal. And we know it's violent. You had the whole Occupy movement and so on. But no one has really come out, as far as I know, or there's no real movement to say, well, not only is this bad, but we can replace it with something better. What is that something better? Is it socialism? Is it Bernie Sanders? what is it? And that, I think, is part of our responsibility. So what I'm trying to do is sort of lay out the problems that we're facing, and then I hope the next stage is people will begin, and we can begin to have a conversation in terms of, all right, what do we do about this? How do you fight interests? How do you fight this military system? How do you deal with a world in which most people are excluded? How do you include them? I mean, how do you restructure the economy? I mean, these are big questions. But in a way, we're not asking them because we don't have a clear political vision. So I guess I'm trying to politicize the discussion. Instead of, as much as I love professors, there's thousands of professors around the world at universities that are writing books and articles. But you don't feel their impact. They're not guiding us. These are people that spend their lives learning, and they have that luxury to learn and to figure out the world and everything else, but they write in arcane journals with a language that nobody understands. It's boring. In other words, they have a responsibility, not every single one of them, but in general, they have a responsibility that they're not fulfilling, and that is helping us to translate their analyses and their concepts, and they have ideas of how a new system could happen, but they're not helping us. And so I think that this kind of a movement of beginning to ask what a better system is something that this kind of work could help promote. The Jews in Israel have really been kind of neutralized. I mean, it's hard to convey this, but everything we're talking about, occupation, Palestinians, war and all that stuff, is a non-issue in Israel. Nobody thinks about it. A long time ago, at Camp David with Barak, the minute Barak said, there is no partner for peace, Palestinians, you know, walked away from the table. They didn't accept a generous offer, which is an urban myth, but nevertheless, there's no partner for peace. Israelis, I mean, this is the prime minister, but he's also the chief of staff of the army before that. He has authority. Israelis took that and simply said, okay, we're washing our hands of this whole matter. The Arabs are intransigent. We tried. They walked away and then did an intifada. Whatever happens, they brought it on themselves. And so we don't have to feel responsible or guilty. And it completely disappeared from the public agenda. In the last election, one of the newspapers did a poll of what the issues were that Israelis were voting on, that they were concerned about. And what we're talking about, occupation, Palestinians, was number 11. Wait, they're talking about the economy and Ashkenazi, Mizrahi ethnic tensions and the latest scandal and religious issues and immigrant issues. They're concerned about African asylum seekers much, much more than they're concerned about Palestinians. The Palestinians are over there somewhere. We don't know where they are. The army's taking care of them. It's not an and it's not our issue anymore. I mean, it's almost as if it's not an Israeli issue. So there's no motivation, and then the economy is doing pretty well, and people are feeling pretty good, and Israel's international status is okay. So there's no real motivation to seek some kind of a solution, I think. And so Israelis are sort of, you know, living in what we call the bubble. So that's why I think they're not going to be proactive in terms of ending this conflict. I mean, they can live with this for another 100 years. So we have to create international pressures, like we did with South Africa, I think, international pressures, and that's what BDS is a part of that, in order to force Israel into a just peace. But to do that, again, we need our own end game. We have to tell them what we want. And if we formulate something like this, a binational democratic state, I think you could get Israelis to accept it. Their concern is security. It isn't land. They don't want the whole land of Israel. There's very few Israelis that are actual settlers. They're concerned about security. And if you can address that concern, I think with pressure, in a de Klerk moment, you could get them to accept the idea, not everybody, but certainly two-thirds of the Israeli public, to accept the idea of a binational democratic state. And it's very much, I think, like South Africa. The South Africans the whites wouldn't have overthrown apartheid on their own. But knowing the ANC had a freedom charter, and then they had a new constitution. So knowing that the idea of the new South Africa was inclusive of everybody, they were willing to give up power, not happy about it, and they wouldn't have done it willingly, but when the international community forced it, they saw that apartheid was unsustainable, there's really no point in fighting it, and they accepted that and then went on with the transition with other problems, but we won't get into that. And I think that's true of Israel as well. If you can offer Israeli Jews a solution that they feel ensures their security, I think they would go much further than what we think. But they're not going to do it themselves. It has to go from the Palestinians and critical Israelis to the international community. You guys have to help create the pressures. And then I think we can create a situation where the occupation is unsustainable for Israel. And then it gives way, but it has to give way to something that Israelis and Palestinians can accept. And that's what we have to articulate, I think. Well, you know, in Gaza, we were talking about 7,000 people. You know, Male Adumim itself, a city in the West Bank, a settlement city, is about 50,000 people. And we're talking about moving 7,000 people versus 600,000 people. So the scale is completely different. And Gaza, you know, the Israelis didn't leave Gaza. I mean, the settlers were taken out of the cage. And then the army came out of the cage, but it remained a cage. Israel didn't give up control of Gaza. So, they could do that with Gaza because Israel never... I tell you why, I think. There's a couple of reasons I won't get into, but one of the reasons is that the settlers used up all the water. There's no more water in Gaza. You know, the groundwater is salinated. A lot of it is sewage. Even now, today, with the floods, because there's a lot of rains, Israel destroyed the sewage system years ago. So people are actually drowning in floods that are more sewage than they are rainwater. Israel blocked the only river going through Gaza that would go through to the sea. It's true, it was used as a kind of a sewer in a way, but at least there was flowing water that would go through to the sea, was blocked by Israel. So now that they don't even have that. So the whole place has become uninhabitable. The UN says that by 2017, which is next year, Gaza will be uninhabitable in terms of the land, the destruction of the land, the inability to grow crops, the lack of water. There's no fish left because in the little pond that Israel's left, the Palestinian fishermen, it's been fished out. So I think that's one of the reasons why Israel left. It was nobody wants Gaza. Israel would like to shift it back to Egypt. Egypt doesn't want it. So it's a very different equation than the West Bank, I think, which is really considered an integral part of Israel itself. And in terms of sane Israelis, you know, you know, a lot of people get caught. I don't know if Israelis are more insane than anyone else. People get caught in situations. I mean, without making compare, you know, I mean, the Germans supported Hitler, and were, you know, got into this, you know, and then a few years later, after the war, you have Konrad Adenauer, and all of a sudden Germany emerges as one of the strongest democracies in the world that's today taking in more refugees. It's more multicultural and multiracial than any other country in the world. But what happened? The Germans were transformed. I mean, the political situation changed. I don't think it's people that really make it. I think people kind of reflect the political system, the economic system, the conflicts that exist, so that I think, you know, South Africa. I mean, we all demonized. We didn't buy wine from South Africa. The whites were, boom. De Klerk happens, Mandela happens, and South Africa is the host of the Olympics. I mean, now they're the good, what, the South African whites changed all of a sudden? So I think that could happen with Israel as well. In other words, people that are think they're caught in a situation of insecurity and violence and so on, I think in another situation would become very different people. So I think we have to less blame the people and try to change the situations they're living in that kind of makes them the way they are. I mean, I don't agree with his analysis. I think you could, this one little story, you know, where, you know, George Wallace, most of us are of an age, you remember George Wallace, stood in the door of the University of Alabama and said, you know, segregation forever. And then in 65, you know, American Congress passes the Voting Rights Act. That is kind of, but pass the Voting Rights Act. All of a sudden, blacks in Alabama get the vote. And Wallace, over the years, becomes a hero almost. I mean, I think in Alabama, if I'm not mistaken, there was a black lieutenant governor, I think, under Wallace at one point. I'm not sure. But at any rate, what I'm saying is, towards the end of his life, George Wallace was given an honorary degree from Tuskegee University. You know, I mean, what happened? Did Wallace change? Did he have a revelation? No, the political situation changed. And he had to respond, and he couldn't be in power anymore with blacks having the vote. And when the situation changed, you know, maybe he changed, but it wasn't dependent on him. Martin Luther King could have talked to him for 100 years about how black people are really good and how they built the country, and he still would have been a segregationist. But you change the situation, and that changes everything. I think that's a better way to look at it than to look at the people themselves. I don't think Israelis are insane or evil. I think they're living in a, I think they're in some ways victims. Together with being oppressors, they're also victims of a certain system as well. Leave it at that.